Good morning again. Good morning. The title of our message today is The Sufficiency of Christ to be a Total Savior. And this is part one because we're going to be discussing this also next week. We just don't have enough time today to cover everything that we want to cover today. I have an advertisement I received in my email recently. This is from the National Geographic Society. It says, your story has a surprise beginning, and it's an advertisement for what's called Geno 2.0. And it's part of a project, a genographic project that they're working on, trying to trace genealogies and histories. The next slide also shows some more of it there. And also, some of you might be familiar with the website genealogy.com. A lot of people are interested in their genealogy today. Where do they come from? Well, we know we all came from God, of course. But what is our human linkage or genes? But people are interested in that. But you know, the Bible discusses genealogy a lot. If you look in the Bible, there's different sections that are devoted to just genealogy. Some of the books of Chronicles not only has history, but a lot of the genealogies of the different patriarchs and the kings and people. But there's one particular genealogy that the New Testament discusses that's very important for us. And who do you think that's the genealogy of? Jesus Christ. And the first part of the chapter 1 in Matthew is devoted to the genealogy of Jesus Christ. And there, Matthew is primarily interested in showing the lineage of Jesus Christ to David. He is the line of the tribe of Judah. He is the kingly king. But in Luke deals with it a little different. Luke doesn't deal with just the highlights going back to Abraham. Luke deals with the entire genealogy of Christ. In fact, if we turn to Luke chapter 3, verse 23, it says, Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, which was the son of Eli. And then it starts to just go backwards, and you come right to the very end, verse 38, which was the son of Enos, which was the son of Seth, which was the son of Adam, which was the son of God. And so clearly delineating the lineage of Christ back through all of humanity. In our next slide, we have a statement from The Desire of Ages, pages 48 and 49. It says, the story of Bethlehem is an exhaustless theme. In it is hidden the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, Romans 11:33. We marvel at the Savior's sacrifice in exchanging the throne of heaven for the manger and the companionship of adoring angels for the beasts of the stall. Human pride and self-sufficiency stand rebuked in his presence. Yet this was but the beginning of his wonderful condescension. It would have been an almost infinite humiliation for the Son of God to take man's nature, even when Adam stood in his innocence in Eden. Now let me just stop there for a minute. How did God make Adam? Was he faulty, defective? No, he was good. In fact, everything that was created was what? Very good. Very good. But even as perfect and majestic as Adam was, she says that it would have been an almost infinite humiliation for the Son of God to take man's nature, even when Adam stood in his innocence before sin in Eden. Continuing, but Jesus accepted humanity when the race had been weakened by 4,000 years of sin. Like every child of Adam, he accepted the results of the working of the great law of heredity. What these results were is shown in the history of his earthly ancestors. He came with such a heredity to share our sorrows and temptations and to give us the example of a sinless life. Now in this statement, she says that he accepted the results of the working of the great law of heredity. What these results were is shown in the history of not just my earthly ancestors, but his earthly ancestors. Well, who were some of the earthly ancestors of Jesus Christ? In our next slide, we would say one of them was Jacob. He's listed there in Matthew chapter 1, verse 2. But who was Jacob? He was a thief, a con man. He was the supplanter, right? You know, Jacob lived a long time compared to us. And it's true that he lived a lot less than Adam and his descendants. But it's not just physical degeneracy here that Ellen White's talking about that happened in humanity over 4,000 years. It's a spiritual degeneracy that he came to this earth to have to deal with primarily. Who else? Well, there was a lady by the name of Tamar, Matthew chapter 1, verse 3. Remember who she was? She was the daughter-in-law of Judah, and she deceived Judah and played the role of a prostitute to him one time. Remember that? She was a descendant of Jesus, one of the descendants of Christ. Not descendant, she was the ancestor of Christ. Well, who else? Rahab, Matthew chapter 1, verse 5. She was a prostitute. She didn't play the role of a prostitute. She was one. She was also a great, 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 so many great grandmothers back of Jesus Christ. Who else? Ruth. Who was Ruth? She was a Moabite. So we've got a Canaanite, a Moabite in the ancestry tree. Who else? Well, we have David. He was a murderer. He was an adulterer. He was a cad at one point in his life, we might say. But you know, there was one guy that's in this lineage that's even worse than David. Who do you think that is? Turn with me in your book, Bible, to 2 Kings chapter 21. Wicked beyond measure. In 2 Kings chapter 21, notice in verse 1, it says, Manasseh was 12 years old when he began to reign, and reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Hephzibah. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord after the abominations of the heathen whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. For he built up again the high places which Hezekiah his father had destroyed. And he reared up altars for Baal, and he made a grove as did Ahab king of Israel, and worshipped all the hosts of heaven and served them. That's not all he did. Verse 4, and he built altars. Not just altars anywhere, but where? Altars in the house of the Lord, which the Lord said in Jerusalem, will I put my name. And he built altars for all the hosts of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord, in the inner court and the outer court. He built these idolatrous places of worship. Verse 6, if that's not bad enough, he made his son pass through the fire. Observed times and used enchantments. And dealt with familiar spirits and wizards. He wrought much wickedness in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. And he set a graven image of the grove that he had made in the house of which the Lord said to David and to Solomon his son, in this house and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all tribes of Israel, will I put my name forever. Neither will I make the feet of Israel move any more out of the land which I gave their fathers, only if they will observe to do according to all that I have commanded them, and according to all the law that my servant Moses commanded them. And now verse 9, but they hearkened not. Remember in the Bible, to hearken or to hear means to what? Obey. But they hearkened not, and Manasseh seduced them to do more evil than did the nations whom the Lord destroyed before the children of Israel. You know, we've all got that Uncle Harry or Aunt Matilda in our family that's a little wild, a little weird, or someone that's just a little flaky, or someone that we might be ashamed of. But I want to tell you, if anyone had a messed up genealogy with all kinds of skeletons in the closet, it was Jesus Christ. But yet, he says, I am not ashamed to call you brethren. He looks at each one of us in our messed up states and in our sin, and he says, I'm still willing to call you brethren. And in Romans chapter 8, Jesus understanding the need of man. Romans chapter 8, verse 7, it says that the carnal mind, and that word carnal is sarx in the Greek, it means what? Who remembers? We've said it before. Flesh. It's the word for flesh. For the carnal mind, the fleshly mind, is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh don't please God? Choose not to please God? What does it say? It says that they cannot please God. Now, is that a little more emphatic than just saying they choose not to or they don't want to? When you can, I mean, there's many things that we want to do sometimes, we just can't do them. We have limitations, restrictions. Paul is saying that humanity, unaided humanity as it is, has a restriction. We cannot please God. When we live in this flesh, and not speaking in a literal sense having flesh, but when we live where the mind is controlled by the flesh, we cannot please God. And God knew that. And Jesus Christ knew it. And if we would continue to our next slide. from the Desire of Ages, pages 122 and 123. It says, in our own strength, it is impossible for us to deny the clamors of our fallen nature. Friends, I think any of us who are honest, we know by experience that that is true. Continuing. Through this channel, what channel? The clamors of the fallen flesh. Through this channel, Satan will bring temptation upon us. Christ knew that the enemy would come to every human being. Don't think, friends, for a minute you get left out. Don't think that Satan's too busy to visit you personally. Christ knew that the enemy would come to every human being to take advantage of hereditary weaknesses and by his false insinuations to ensnare all who would trust, whose trust is not in God. And by passing over the ground which man must travel, our Lord has prepared the way for us to overcome. Desire of Ages, pages 122 and 123. Now notice it says that he has passed over the way that we must go so that he can help us. And so if he's passed over the way that we must go, he must know something about what it means to have fallen sinful flesh. In other words, he knows what it's like to have a Canaanite, a Moabitess, a murderer, someone involved in enchantments and witchcraft and things as their family tree history. I like a text. We were talking last night at worship about one of our favorite psalms, other than maybe Psalms 119, you know, a shorter psalm. And one of my favorite psalms, and I didn't mention it last night, is Psalms 20. But just that first verse, can we look at Psalms 20 and verse 1? The Lord hear thee in the day of trouble. The name of the God of Jacob defend thee. Now who's Jacob again? He was that cheat. He was that supplanter. He was that con man. And God says that I'm the God of Jacob. Now if it was me, I might have said I'm the God of Jesus Christ. Holy, pure, undefiled. I might have said, I'm the God of Daniel, or the God of Enoch, or the God of a Virgin Mary, a virgin so pure and holy that God would choose this woman to be the mother of Jesus Christ. But it does something different here. He says, I'm the God of Jacob. And he brings up that name over and over throughout the scriptures to show that he associates himself with fallen, sinful people. And that, as it were, we might say, God keeps bad company. Now, the early years of Jesus Christ are very lightly touched upon the scriptures. We just have a few verses. We can look at a couple of them quickly in Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. In fact, Ellen White, she refers to this time in the life of Christ in Testimonies of Sabbath School Work on page 105 as the hidden years. She calls these the hidden years. Very little said about them. But we have a little bit here. And we have enough to understand a little bit of his life as a child. And we have some of the spirit of prophecy that amplifies it. In Luke chapter 2, verse 40, it says, and the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Now, how do you grow strong in spirit? I know that if you want your biceps to get bigger, you do these curls and you lift things. And if you want your shoulders to be stronger, you can do presses. But how do you make your spirit stronger? What does that mean? It's talking about your mind, isn't it? That person who you are. And he does this by having a connection with God, by being drawn close to God. In verse 52, and Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. And the spirit of prophecy draws back, as it were, part of the veil that we only see just a few hints of here. If we would proceed to our next slide. The record of the childhood and youth of Jesus is to be an encouragement to all children and youth. Jesus is the perfect pattern, and it is the duty and privilege of every child and youth to copy the pattern. Let children bear in mind that Jesus Christ had taken upon himself human nature, and it was in the likeness of sinful flesh and was tempted of Satan, as all children are tempted. He was able to resist the temptation of Satan through his dependence upon the divine power of his heavenly Father, as he was subject to his will and obedient to all his commands. He kept his Father's statutes, precepts, and laws. He was continually seeking counsel of God and was obedient to his will. But notice, and I just put up here on the next slide for emphasis, he was able to resist the temptations of Satan through his dependence upon the divine power of his heavenly Father, as he was subject to his will, the Father's will, and obedient to all his commands. And friends, we have the same need today, to be dependent upon divine power. And if we will allow ourselves to be dependent upon divine power, then even though we are in sinful flesh, flesh that of itself cannot please God, we have something more powerful than sinful flesh. We have the indwelling power of Jesus Christ. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4 says, "Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." Now, it's been a paradox to people for a long time how Jesus Christ could take upon himself, take upon his sinless nature, our sinful nature, and still be victorious. And these are questions that we hear in theology today, and they were around in the time of Ellen White. And one person who had a question about that was a man by the name of Frank, or F.E. Belden. You ever hear of F.E. Belden? He was a nephew of Ellen White. And he wrote some beautiful songs, songs like "Not I But Christ." And apparently he had written to his auntie about some questions he had concerning the incarnation. So she wrote him back. And she said this to him in our next slide. "He was made like unto his brethren," Hebrews 2:17. "He felt both joy and grief as they feel." And now notice what else it says. "His body was susceptible to weariness as yours," but she doesn't limit it to just his body. She goes on. "His mind, like yours, could be harassed and perplexed. If you had hardships, so had he. If you had conflicts, so had he. If you need encouragement, so did he." You ever need encouragement? I do. Even Jesus Christ needed encouragement. Of course, he looked to God for his encouragement. He didn't look to his own problems. He didn't look to self. He didn't look to others. He looked to God for encouragement. She goes on to say, "If you need encouragement, so did he. Satan could tempt him. His enemies could annoy him. The ruling powers could torture his body. The soldiers could crucify him. And they can do no more to us." Continuing, "Jesus was exposed to hardships, to conflict and temptations as a man. He became the captain of our salvation through suffering. He could bear his burden better than we, for he bore it without complaint, without impatience, without unbelief, without repining. But this is no evidence he felt it less than any of the suffering sons of Adam. Jesus was sinless and had no dread of the consequences of sin. With this exception, his condition was as yours." In other words, he was tempted in all points like us, yet without sin. But I thought this was interesting in the first paragraph we were reading here, where she says that he could bear this burden better than we do because he bore it without complaint. But let me ask you something. Do we have to complain? You know, we could quit complaining, couldn't we? We could quit being impatient, couldn't we? We could quit having unbelief, couldn't we? We could have faith instead. We could do all things without murmuring and complaining. And we would find life a lot sweeter and a lot happier. And that's the way Jesus found it. And he had no dread of the consequence of sin, because there was no sin in him. Now, one thing we need to make very clear here, and I think we can see this in the book of James, if we turn to James chapter 1, and that is that there is a distinct difference between temptation and sin. There are sometimes people feel like if they have been tempted to do something wrong, that they have been sinning or they have sinned. But notice what James says here, all right, through the book of Hebrews, James chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. It says, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and is enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin when it is finished bringeth forth death. The wages of sin is death." It's when we take these desires, and then we dwell upon them, then we act upon them, then we have sinned. But just having a temptation, just a wrong thought being interjected into your mind, seemingly an out-of-the-blue moment, is not sin. Satan can somehow do that. I don't know how he does that. But he can bring to our mind certain things, seemingly off the cuff, out of the blue, or sometimes not so much out of the blue. But what do we do with those thoughts? What do we do with those insinuations, those temptations? Do we immediately repel them as Jesus did? Do we turn our back to them? Or do we sit and dwell, well, you know, that would be sort of nice, you know. I like that guy's car over there. I'd like to have that guy's car over there. Maybe if I could, you know. We can do that. We can have all kinds of problems. But the temptations of Jesus Christ were very real. But they did not constitute sin. No one has ever been tempted greater in this world than Jesus Christ. His temptations, especially in the wilderness, were a reality. In other words, when Satan came tempting him to do wrong, Jesus really had the ability, he had the option to choose to do what was wrong, and he could have done what was wrong, but he chose not to. When he said, for instance, as it was prophesied in Psalms 22, verse 1, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Did he really mean that? Discussing recently the English writer Shakespeare and whether it was appropriate for Seventh-day Adventist Christians to study Shakespeare. And Shakespeare wrote a lot of plays, you know. People pretending. And some of those have spiritualistic sessions in them and overtones and violence and murder and all kinds of things. But they're plays. They weren't reality. They didn't really happen. I mean, well, I wrote a play on Julius Caesar, and that was based to a degree, perhaps, on the facts, but probably just a smidging. So when Jesus was on the cross, was it like a great Shakespearean play? God, I know you're there. I know you're going to take care of me. I know I'm going through. I can see through the portal of the tomb anyhow, but I'm going to say, why have you forsaken me? I'm going to inspire my servant to write that Jesus could not see through the portal of the tomb, even though he really could. Was there meaning in all of the temptations for Jesus, or was it just play acting? In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15, it says, we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. He says that we do have a high priest who is touched, who does understand the feeling of our infirmities. If we would proceed to our next slide. There we are told from the youth instructor of July 20, 1899, unless there is a possibility of yielding, temptation is no temptation. Temptation is resisted when man is powerfully influenced to do a wrong action, and knowing that he can do it, resists by faith with a firm hold upon divine power. This was the ordeal through which Christ passed. He could not have been tempted in all points as man is tempted, had there been no possibility of his falling. He was a free agent, placed on probation as was Adam, and as is every man. Youth instructor, July 20, 1899. Now I want to talk about what the Spirit of Prophecy speaks of as passions for just a moment. I want to look at a couple statements. The first one is found in Spalding McGann, page 209. It says, the lower passions have their seat in the body and work through it. And then in Christ Optic Lessons on page 346, our impulses and passions have their seat in the body, and it must be kept in the best condition physically and under the most spiritual influences in order that our talents may be put to the highest use. You see, the body and the mind, they sympathize with each other. And so if our bodies are not in the best physical condition, it's easier for the mind to succumb to the passions of the flesh. You see, Satan wants to take the flesh and control our mind with it. Right? Satan wants to take our flesh and control the mind with it. But friends, God has an opposite program. He wants to take our minds and control the flesh. See? And we have to contend with all these issues that we have, many due to inheritance. You know, I'm not talking about just a receding hairline or a weak eye or, you know, a degeneracy of physical nature. I'm talking about the spiritual tendencies, the tendencies that we have spiritually that somehow are in us genetically that maybe we can't understand or explain due to our heritage. We have to contend with these things. And I want to tell you that, yes, indeed, Jesus Christ also had to deal with such tendencies and temptations. And if he were not tempted as we were, then he could not be a total Savior. He must live as we live. In Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, on page 177, it says, "He knows how strong are the inclinations of the natural heart, and he will help in every time of temptation." What kind of heart? The natural heart, the heart that you naturally have. The heart you naturally have, is it a good heart? No, it's not. But he understands these things and says that he can help. And these issues on the incarnation, friends, again, they are not new. I mentioned that her nephew, Belden, had written concerning about it. And in Ellen White's time, she was getting questions, and there were erroneous ideas going about it. And I found this interesting. In Selected Messages, Book 1, on page 408, look at the very first word, letters. Letters, what does that mean? Plural. Probably several letters have been coming into me affirming that Christ could not have had the same nature as man, for if he had, he would have fallen under similar temptations. If he did not have man's nature, he could not be our example. If he was not a partaker of our nature, he could not have been tempted as man has been. If it were not possible for him to yield to temptation, he could not be our helper. It was a solemn reality that Christ came to fight the battles as a man in man's behalf. His temptation and victory tell us that humanity must copy the pattern. Man must become a partaker of the divine nature. Let me just stop here. Two words, substitution and example. There's a theology that says Christ is simply our example, and there's a theology that says he's simply our substitute. But friends, he's both our substitute and he's our example. And if he fails on either account, he is not the complete Savior for us. But we are told here that humanity must copy this pattern. That means he's an example that we must follow. That's an emphatic word, must. And we can believe it or we can set it aside. And there's many who have chosen to set it aside and say, you know, Jesus has done everything for us. He has obeyed for us. He has lived for us. And our obedience is not so important now as long as we are in Jesus. But friends, if we are really in Jesus, we will obey. Because he has become our pattern and our example. In our next slide, it says, "The victory gained was designed not only to set an example to those who have fallen under the power of appetite." This is referring to the temptation of Christ in the wilderness. "But to qualify the Redeemer for his special work of reaching to the very depths of human woe, by experiencing in himself the strength of Satan's temptations and of human suffering and infirmities, he would know how to succor those who should put forth efforts to help themselves." Now again, what was the record in Eden of the creation that God had made? It was all, in Genesis 1:31, it says it was very good. God made everything beautiful and perfect. And the record of Eden is perfection in its beginning. And Adam could, at first in Eden, only be tempted at one place. Where was that one place that Adam could be tempted? The tree of knowledge of good and evil. In other words, Satan couldn't tempt him anywhere else. And not only that, but apparently from everything we understand, there was nothing that could tempt Adam from within. As he was created, he had no bent to evil. But Christ in accepted humanity could be tempted both from without and from within. If we could proceed to our next slide, part of a long quotation here. "The great work of redemption could be carried out only by the Redeemer taking the place of fallen man or unfallen man? Fallen man. Burdened with the sins of the world, he must go over the ground where Adam stumbled. He must take up the work just where Adam failed and endure a test of the same character, but infinitely more severe than that which had vanquished him. It is impossible for man to fully comprehend the strength of Satan's temptations to our Savior. Every enticement to evil, which men find so difficult to resist, was brought to bear upon the Son of God in as much greater degree as his character was superior to that of fallen man. Let me pause there. How much greater is his character to mine? I mean, it's infinite, isn't it? And it says that the temptation that was brought upon him was to the same degree, or is in a much greater degree, as his character was superior to that of fallen man. Continuing. When Adam was assailed by the tempter, he was without the taint of sin. He stood before God in the strength of perfect manhood. All the organs and faculties of his being fully developed and harmoniously balanced. He was like a fine Swiss watch, friends. And he was surrounded with the things of beauty and conversed daily with the holy angels. What a contrast to this perfect being did the second Adam present as he entered the desolate wilderness to cope with Satan single-handed. For 4,000 years, the race had been decreasing in size and physical strength and deteriorating in moral worth. And in order to elevate fallen man, Christ must reach him where he stood. He assumed human nature, bearing the infirmities and degeneracy of the race. He humiliated himself to the lowest depths of human woe that he might fully sympathize with man and rescue him from the degradation into which sin had plunged him. She says that he humiliated himself to the lowest depths. Anybody know what a hilgermite is? Do you know what a hilgermite is? Well, there's one on my door down at my house this morning. I don't know if it's still there or not. But they're a little insect. They can get quite big. They're very ugly. They're one of the ugliest things you'll ever see. Can you imagine being turned into a hilgermite? That'd be pretty humiliating, wouldn't it? But I don't think it would be as humiliating as being turned into a human if you were the divine Son of God. I mean, you just think of something that you detest, maybe a cockroach, a grub. How'd you like to live as a cockroach, feeding where they feed, eating what they eat, and living in the places they live? Yeah, and that sounds nasty. It sure does. Linda's got that face that tells me she agrees. But think about what it meant to the moral purity of Christ to come and to inhabit fallen, sinful flesh and to live in this fallen world of sin. I mean, it's a beautiful, beautiful testimony of his great love and the love of the Father sent him. And I'll tell you further than that, I'd like to credit my angels today that are there to help us and who concede to come to this world. And instead of being around the throne of God, where I think in many respects they would rather be praising God and showing him adoration and praise, they do his will. They love God. They show their love by being obedient to his command to come to this world and to help us out. And so I'd like to say that today in behalf of the beautiful, wonderful angels that do minister to us. But the fight of Jesus against sin, friends, it was no play. It was no sham. It was the real deal. It meant something. In Isaiah chapter 9, we have this prophecy about Jesus. And there's a part of it we don't hear really mentioned very much. But I think it's one of the most important aspects of it. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. What does it mean that the government is upon his shoulder? Well, whose government? Is it the government of Rome, Caesar, Babylon, Medo-Persia? No, it's the government of God, isn't it? And when you place something upon your shoulders, you're carrying it, you're sustaining it, you're supporting it. And the government of God was going to be sustained and supported by Jesus Christ. He was going to carry the burden of the government of God. Whether indeed God was truly honest, God was truly righteous, and God's way were truly the best ways. And if he failed, it was going to be a failure of God. It was going to be a failure of the universe. And he carried that, and that was a very real burden for him. If we would continue in the desire of ages, Satan in heaven had hated Christ for his position in the courts of God. Let me stop there. What was the position that he hated him for? Was it the second person of the Trinity? He was jealous because he was the Son of God. Continuing, he hated him the more when he himself was dethroned. He hated him who pledged himself to redeem a race of sinners. Yet into the world where Satan claimed dominion, God permitted his son to come, a helpless babe, subject to the weaknesses of humanity. He permitted him to meet life's peril in common with every human soul, to fight the battle as every child of humanity must fight it, at the risk of failure and eternal loss. Continuing, she says, the heart of the human father yearns over his son. He looks into the face of his little child and trembles at the thought of life's peril. He longs to shield his dear one from Satan's power, to hold him back from temptation and conflict, to meet a bitter conflict and a more fearful risk. God gave his only begotten son that the path of life might be made sure for our little ones. Herein is love. Desire of Ages, page 49. Now, think about the purity of Jesus for just a moment. Here he is, he's so pure, and he's come to live in this world of defilement. And to show his connection with this, he did something I think is just one of the most beautiful, touching things in the Bible. It's just a few verses about it. Mark chapter 1, we'll begin in verse 39. And he preached in their synagogues throughout all Galilee and cast out devils. And now the story really begins in verse 40. And there came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him, and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. Now, if Jesus had simply commanded this leper, be thou clean, what would have happened? It would have immediately happened. He would be clean. And many times he would just simply speak the word, and the power of God would be acted upon. But he did something he didn't have to do, but yet he had to do. To touch humanity and to show us that he's willing to touch humanity. He did something that, to my knowledge, had never been voluntarily ever done in the history of this earth. You see, when someone became a leper, they were diseased, it was highly contagious, and that person had to be isolated or quarantined. If a leper was in society, they had to veil themselves. If anyone was coming near, they would have to shout, unclean, unclean, to let people know, I'm a leper, don't come near me. And a person who was clean, ritually and physically clean, would never, and was to never touch a leper. But he who knew no defilement, he who in his character was absolutely perfection of purity, could touch the leper without being defiled and without becoming unclean. Jesus received no pollution from the leper, and he was immediately cleansed. And in the Desire of Ages, on page 266, we have this statement. Thus it is with the leprosy of sin. Deep-rooted, deadly, and impossible to be cleansed by human power. The whole head is sick and the whole heart faint. From the sole of the foot, even into the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. Isaiah 1, 5 and 6. But Jesus, coming to dwell in humanity, receives no pollution. His presence has healing virtue for the sinner. Whoever will fall at his feet, saying in faith, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean, shall hear the answer, I will, be thou clean. Now, we're not talking about leprosy here. We're not talking about cancer here. We're not talking about heart disease here. God has the power to cleanse and to heal all those problems. Don't get me wrong. And sometimes he chooses to do that. And I think he will for every believing, faithful person. He may not do it in this life, but in the next life, he's going to heal everybody of those things who comes to him in faith. But what about sin? That's what we've got to be healed of, this leprosy of sin. And if we will come kneeling before him, it doesn't matter how bad we've been, because it depends, in the time of Christ, it didn't get any worse than leprosy. That was the epitome of illness. That was the pinnacle of being sick, of being an outcast. And Jesus says, come unto me, all ye that labor heavy laden. You're burned down with sin, you're burned down with your impatience, you're burned down with your depression, you're burned down with your lusts and passions of this world. You come to me, and I will touch you, and I will speak to you, and you will be clean. Because I've been there, and I know what it's like. And this experience of Christ healing the leper has important lessons besides the basic narrative. Though Jesus, in accepting our fallen humanity, was in constant touch with the drives, the strengths, the passions, and the inclinations of humanity, we are told this as we read it in The Youth Instructor of June 2, 1898. With his human arm, Christ encircling the race, while with his divine arm, he grasps the throne of the infinite, uniting finite man with the infinite God. He bridged the gulf that sin had made and connected earth with heaven. In his human nature, he maintained the purity of his divine character. His divine character. In Romans chapter 8, verses 3 and 4, the Apostle Paul says this concerning Christ. For what the law could not do, and it was weak through the flesh, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. You see, the carnal mind, the fleshly mind, is the same word for flesh here, sarx in the Greek. This is contrary to the will of God, and it's not subject to the will of God and cannot be. But if we have the Spirit of Christ dwelling within us, then he who came and took the likeness of sinful flesh will repeat the miracle of his life that he performed 2,000 years ago in our life today. And that's the great hope we have. From Selected Messages, Book 1, we should have no misgivings in regard to the perfect sinlessness of the human nature of Christ. Our faith must be an intelligent faith, looking into Jesus in perfect confidence, in full and entire faith in the atoning sacrifice. This is essential that the soul may not be enshrouded in darkness. The Holy Substitute is able to save to the uttermost, for he presented to the wondering universe perfect and complete humility in his human character and perfect obedience to all the requirements of God. Now, she says we should have no misgivings regarding the perfect sinlessness of his character, of his humanity. What she's saying is that he never sinned. But yet, he came and accepted, took upon his sinless nature, our sinful nature, a nature that has propensities to sin, a fleshly nature. He had those drawings, friends, not just simply the temptations from without by Satan, but the drawings from within. And yet to every one of those, he turned a deaf ear, a blind eye to, as it were. And he only would serve God. He would never serve himself or his flesh. And he is able to save to the uttermost all who come to God by him today because of that. But it says in this statement that he presented to the wondering universe perfect and complete humility in his human character. You see, there's a wondering universe that's looking in upon us. Someone has said that this earth is the theater of the universe, and that's maybe a little misterm because theaters imply acting, and this is very much real what's happening here. But it is a stage where we are all players, as perhaps Shakespeare did say one time. This is a place where we are all in a death and life struggle for eternal life. And Jesus is able to save today. Jesus touches humanity today. In his perfect humanity and perfect divinity, Jesus is able to bridge the gulf between you and God today. He is able to lift you up and to present you faultless before God, not in some sham, but with the genuine article of his own perfect righteousness. Jesus still keeps company today with bad people, and he will keep company with you. And he is able to save to the uttermost all who come unto God by him. I have a friend down the road, and I think you know who he is, Kevin. They call him Jackie. And she spent some time in Vietnam as a soldier. And he did some things that he just doesn't feel like he can be forgiven of. But he can be, because Jesus can save him to the uttermost. And I thought about this situation. I was thinking about this last night, Kevin's son. We look upon this life. We look upon this life, which is so temporal, as if it's eternal. Now think about that. We look upon this temporal life as if it's so eternal in this sense. When this man was in Vietnam, and I'm just telling you a story that could be repeated by many, many people who were there or in any war. He used his rifle. He shot and he killed people. And he may have killed people that were innocent people at times. And it's got to be a continual nightmare to him because he doesn't have the forgiveness of Jesus in his life. And he says, God can't forgive me for doing that, because he's looking at that sin, as great as it was, as something that's eternal, rather than something temporal. Because in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 28, Jesus told us something here, and we can apply it to this. He says, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul." We can go to war. We could go to Vietnam. We could go to Germany in World War II. We could go to those trenches in France in World War I. And we could shoot 100 soldiers. But no one should fear me, because I can't kill the soul. And no one can take the soul of another person. No one can force your salvation away from you. Only you can give that up of yourself. And so we look upon that which is temporal as eternal, instead of looking upon the eternal things in their right light. And so God can save any of us. It doesn't matter how bad we've done, because we haven't shut off anyone's probation. Maybe we have shut their probation off. We have sealed when their life ends. It's true, we can do that. But we can't make that person be lost. That person makes their own decision whether they're going to be saved or lost. And I can shoot 100 people. I could go into a bank and shoot 100 people. I could come into a church and shoot 50 people, 1,000 people. But that doesn't mean that I have condemned any of them to hell. They have a personal choice with Jesus Christ. And so what we do on this earth, it's terrible. It's sin. It deserves death. It's true. But God can forgive us of these things, because those people still have the possibility of eternal life. And so we should fear, respect, and love the one who only gives eternal life. Do the names Lovell, Swaggart, and Halsey mean anything to any of you? Have you ever heard these names before? They were astronauts. If I remember what particular mission these three teamed up on, they were on the ill-fated Apollo 13 mission. Apollo 13, that on April 11th of 1970 took off from Kennedy Space Center in Florida with the idea that they were going to land on the moon. But 2 days later, on the 13th of April, something happened. There was an explosion in the service module that the command module attached to. And that explosion put their lives in tremendous jeopardy. In fact, at first, it just seemed like they were just going to be stranded in space, and there'd be no way that they would be able to get back. But they had this little device, not a little device, but they had what they called the LEM, the lunar module, that was to go with them. And it was going to be the landing and coming back to the command module to go back to Earth on. And they used it, as it were, as a life raft. They went into this, into the lunar module. They used the facilities of the lunar module. But there were a lot of problems. The lunar module itself didn't have everything that they needed, and there wasn't enough oxygen there. There weren't the carbon dioxide scrubbers there that purified the air. And there were just so many things that happened that everything is sort of like everything that could go wrong went wrong at this particular moment. They didn't have enough water. They were getting sick. There was almost no heat. They were in unbearably cold temperatures for days trying to get back. And yet NASA put their greatest scientists to the task of trying to figure out how to keep these men, first of all, alive, and secondly, how to get them back to the Earth and then get them through with possibly a damaged heat shield, which they realized that heat shield had been damaged in the explosion, that they weren't probably going to survive. But hope against all hope, we know the story. They got back. We know they got back. But they expended so much to try to get them back. Every effort, every possible brain power that they could muster into coming up with ideas. You know, they would figure a pattern, a trajectory, and they'd say, well, this comes up 3 hours short. It just doesn't get them here in time. They've run out of air by this time. And they would figure up another trajectory. And they say, well, this one comes in at the wrong angle, and it's going to sling them off into space, and they'll never get back in orbit. And the men just said, as the head of the flight crew came in, he said, I just want to tell you one thing. He says, failure is unacceptable. He says, failure is unacceptable. We're going to do this. I don't know how, but we're going to do this, and failure is unacceptable. Gene Kranz was his name. And I want to tell you that there was a day that God and Christ sat down together, and I think in one way or another they said, failure is unacceptable. This is going to work. If you had shown the depths of what sin would be like to the angels, if you could have explained to this universe that's watching, that only speaks about that we don't understand who's out there, what's out there, if you could have explained to them the depths of sin, they would have said, this is impossible. There's no way that those beings could ever be redeemed. It just can't be done. But God said, failure is not possible. And he took the most extreme action in sending his son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, but he did this so that the righteousness of God might be in you. Friends, don't be ever tempted to get, we could be tempted to give up. We're all tempted to give up at times. I received a letter from a dear sister this week. She said, I was tempted to give up, but I listened on. We can be tempted, friends. Don't ever give in to that temptation to give up, because God didn't. And he has sent his son to die for you, and he has sent his son to live in a way that you have to live, so that he can help you in all of your trials. It doesn't matter what it is, friends, in principle. You know, I know Jesus didn't have rock and roll music. He didn't have computers to deal with. But in principle, he had all the things, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He had, in principle, everything that we deal with. And he knows how to help us today. And he will help you today if you will turn to him for your help. We have a wonderful Savior in Jesus our Lord. Let us accept him today and walk with him in the sweet by and by to come.